now no longer but Christ in me. I will run to the cross where you opened up my eyes. I will sing of the life that saved me. I will bow in the place where death became my life. I will run to the cross. Oh, how endless the hope.
Good morning, Life Church. Welcome to our outdoor service. So glad to see all of you, despite it being a little chilly this morning. Let's stand and sing. The reason we've gathered here today is to bring worship to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So let's sing this song together. Light of the world.
Voices to the Lord.
Here I am to worship.
Good morning, Knife Church. How is everybody this morning? Good, good. It's a little cold this morning, so this bald head, I hope y'all don't mind the cap. But my name is Jesse Johnson, and me and my wife Marie are members here at Life Church. And it's good to see y'all and welcome everyone. If you're visiting today, we're glad to have you and hope you consider coming back. And it's great to be out on this piece of property. I'm also a member of the Together We Grow team. And just wanted to give y'all a quick update that as we're out here on, as what I call the home of Life Church, not the future home. This is where God has called us, and what a great and wonderful place. I'm excited to say that since June, we have paid off, the total debt was $400,000, but since June, when we started the Together We Grow campaign, we have paid off $225,000 in debt. So there we go. We only have, I think it's like $168,000 left to go. And it's exciting to see that, be a part of it. And, it's one of the people that were giving one of these updates talked about how awesome it is to be called to be a part of a church at this moment. As we're building a church building, I mean, we are the church. We're building a church building. And often in my job, I get to ride all around the countryside and I see these old churches. And I just, this has made me think about, at one time they were just a gathering of people and church members, and they built a building and had worship and changed lives. And it's just exciting to have the opportunity to be part of a church as we're in this process. I'm excited about it and look forward to what God has called us to here. And this is my first time doing this, so I apologize, but Aaron. Do I need to say a brief prayer? Is that all right? You got it? All right. Anyway, sorry. Good to see y'all.
Good morning, guys. I want to invite all of our youngest Life Church family buddies to come on up, and we're going to have just a quick kids message. Thank you, Eli. Just come on up and join us. If you've got toddlers and they're more comfortable sitting in a mama's lap, feel free to come on up with them. Just join us right up here. Good morning, friends. How are you? Is it a little chilly this morning? Yeah. So I wanted to just talk to you a little bit about this time of year where we see lots of fun things. We see trips to pumpkin patches, and we get to dress up in fun costumes sometimes, and we even carve pumpkins. Has anybody carved a pumpkin with their family?
Yeah.
Yes. What was inside of it? Goo and seeds and fun stuff. Well, I want to read a book to you this morning. You made a bubble, okay. This is called The Pumpkin Patch Parable. Do any of my friends remember what a parable is? Nope, at least you're honest. Thank you. A parable is a story that teaches us a lesson about how to follow Jesus, about what kind of life Jesus wants us to lead. So can I read this to you? See that big red barn and those rolling green fields? That's where the farmer lives, way out in the country. It's so far out, the streets don't even have stop signs. Do any of y'all live in the country? Yeah. You do, Oliver. The farmer grows lots of different things in those fields. He grows tall green corn and big red tomatoes, long yellow squash, and even little green peas. People eat that stuff for dinner. Do you eat those kind of foods? You're honest about that too, thank you. But the best vegetable the farmer grows is a pumpkin. They start out as flat oval seeds, almost as big as raisins. One hot June day, soon after school let out, the farmer planted pumpkin seeds just like he did every summer. The seeds disappeared into the ground in nice, neat rows and grew there in the dark all through the 4th of July. Do any of y'all plant gardens at your house? You do, Kirsten? You do?
You saved your pumpkin seeds? Oh. Early one morning, a tiny green shoot quietly poked its way out of the soil. Soon, a long green vine stretched across the ground. From that vine, little buds sprouted into wide green leaves. The leaves spread out flat to catch the August sun. Some days, those little green buds would turn into big orange pumpkins. But not yet. The patient farmer waited and waited. Two, God is being patient with you. He does not want anyone to be lost. He wants everyone to change his heart and life. 2 Peter 3:9. The pumpkins began to grow, and how different they looked. Some were tall and lean, some were short and round, some had lumps and bumps, but all of them were pumpkins. My hand made all things are here because I made them, says the Lord. Isaiah 66:2. October came at last. The sky was bright and blue and the air was cooler. Every night it got dark earlier than it did the night before. Have y'all noticed that? Does anybody have to go to bed before the moon comes out and it's still light outside? Yeah. It was time for the farmer to harvest his pumpkin crop. The farmer's many workers brought lots of ripe pumpkins in from the fields. Which one would he choose first? You think he'd choose the biggest pumpkin? The farmer picked up one large pumpkin, being very careful not to let it slip through his hands. Pumpkins are tough on the outside, but they break into smithereens if you drop them. He washed off all the dirt, holding on tight. Next came the messy part. Who likes this part? Does anybody not like this part? Pumpkins are full of dozens of seeds and lots of slimy pulp. The farmer had a special plan for his chosen pumpkin, so the seeds and the slime had to go. Psalm 51:10 says, "Create in me a pure heart, O God." He slowly slid a large knife right into the center of the pumpkin. The pumpkin didn't make a sound, though, because vegetables don't talk. If they did talk, the pumpkin might have said, "Ouch." Gently, the farmer cut a round hole in top of the pumpkin and pulled on the stem. Squishy, stringy pulp waited for him inside. Yuck. "I am the Lord, and I can look into a person's heart." Jeremiah 17:10. This part of the story reminds us that we all have what inside of our hearts? Sin. We all have sin in our heart, and God sees that. Just like the pumpkin has yucky stuff, we have yucky stuff inside of us too. The farmer pulled out all that slimy pulp, wrapped it up in an old newspaper, and off to the compost pile it went, never to be seen again. "He has taken our sins away from us as far as the east is from the west." Psalm 103:12. Then something really exciting happened. The pumpkin got a new face. We all show the Lord's glory, and we are being changed to be like him. 2 Corinthians 3:18. The farmer carved a triangle for each eye. Pumpkins have eyes that don't blink or turn away. They see everything. The eye is a light for the body. If your eyes are good, then your whole body will be full of light. Matthew 6:22. He neatly carved a little square nose and then a big, wide smile. What happened next was wonderful. The farmer put a small white candle down inside the pumpkin and touched the wick with a flame. And how that pumpkin glowed. God once said, "Let the light shine out of the darkness." And this is the same God who made his light shine in our hearts. 2 Corinthians 4:6. As the sky grew darker, the pumpkin on the porch was shining brighter than ever. When people saw the smiling pumpkin, they smiled back. In the same way, you should be a light for other people. Live so that they will see the good things you do. Live so that they will praise your Father in heaven. Matthew 5:16. All the neighbors knew that once again, the farmer had turned a simple pumpkin into a simply glorious sight. In the same way, God the Father offers his children the chance to be made new, full of joy, full of light, shining like stars in a dark world. If anyone belongs to Christ, then he is made new. The old things have gone, and everything is made new. 2 Corinthians 5:17. So when you see a jack-o'-lantern this year, I want you to remember that God can take out all of the slimy stuff inside of our hearts, all of the sin, and he can make us new when we choose to follow him. Okay, can we pray? Okay. Dear Lord, thank you so much for the blessing of being out here on this property this morning, to feel the cool air, to be together as a church family. Lord, we pray for each of the hearts here that they would be spoken to, that they would hear you moving in their midst. Lord, bring us into a time of worship and praise as we lift our voices to you. In Jesus' name, amen. As they're returning to their seats, let's stand again as we sing together. Great love of the Father.
Jesus, you endure my pain. Savior, you bore all my shame. Savior, you bore all my shame. All because of your love.
Maker of the universe.
Maker of the universe. Broken for the sins of the earth, all because of your love, all because of your love.
Sing this out. Because of your cross, my debt is paid.
Because of your cross, my debt is paid. Because of Because of your blood, my sins are washed.
sing this hymn.
Turn your eyes.
And turn your eyes upon Jesus.
Look full.
Look full in his wonderful face. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace.
Let's lift that up one more time. Turn your eyes.
Thank you for your great love that you poured out upon us, Father. You love us so much that you sent your son to die on a cross for us, Father. We thank you for that. We pray now that as Josh comes to bring the word this morning, Father, that you would just fill him up with your spirit, Lord, that we would hear and receive the word that you have for us this morning. We love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Better. Hey, that's a lot better. Gotta get set up here. Isaiah chapter 43, beginning in verse 5, says, "Fear not, for I am with you. I will bring your offspring from the east, and from the west I will gather you. I will say to the north, give up, and to the south, do not withhold. Bring my sons from afar, and my daughters from the end of the earth. Everyone who is called by my name, whom I created for my glory, whom I formed and made." Let's pray this morning. Heavenly Father, it is a privilege to be out in your creation this morning as we join with the sun that is shining and the wind that is blowing to sing praise and magnify your name. God, you are the creator, the sustainer, the giver of life. Father, your word gives us life. We praise you today because you are worthy of praise, and it is the best thing that we can do. Lord, help us today to make much of you, to portray you as the glorious God that you are. Lord, speak to us through your word this morning. Be honored in this place, in this patch of woods this morning. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. That wind's pretty bad, isn't it? A little better? Maybe. Well, good morning. My name is Josh Brubaker. I'm part of our elder team here. I am not Pastor Nolan or Pastor Stephen. I had the privilege of receiving a text of encouragement from Pastor Nolan this morning from Honduras, where they're doing some reconnaissance to see about a short-term mission trip for Life Church next year. This is pretty bad. It's windy. So a few weeks ago, I talked with Pastor Nolan about filling in today. And I said, you know, that's the 31st of October. How would you feel about doing a topical message? I told him what I was thinking about, and he said, yeah, that sounds good. So here we are. 504 years ago today, a German monk named Martin started to develop some convictions about the teachings of the Roman Catholic Church at that time. And so many, many years before Frank Costanza and Festivus Revelry would declare, I got a lot of problems with you people, and now you're going to hear about it. Martin Luther would list out 95 objections to the teachings of the Catholic Church. He would nail them to the door of the church at Wittenberg, Germany, October 31st, 1517. So happy Reformation Day. Did you guys think I was going to preach on Halloween? Maybe another time. So this would begin the what we know as the Protestant Reformation. You know Martin's objections as his 95 theses. And they were numerous, but they really keyed in on three teachings of the Catholic Church that he felt did not line up with Scripture as he had studied it. Martin's conversion is an interesting story. He was studying to be a lawyer. He got caught in a thunderstorm and was so terrified that he was going to die that he cried out to the Lord and said, "If you rescue me, I'll become a monk." God rescued him, and he became a monk. And in his studies, he started to see that a lot of these teachings just didn't line up with what he understood from Scripture. Primarily, he identified things like purgatory. If you guys are familiar, the intermediary place of punishment where you would have to endure some punishment before you could go on into heaven. The idea of penance, that you have to pay some sort of a penalty or do some good works to receive absolution of your sin. It was primarily confession and absolution by a priest. Martin said that doesn't work with Scripture. And then the big one was the sale of indulgences. So the priests, especially as they had building campaigns, it became really corrupt. They would sell indulgences, and the idea is that you could purchase forgiveness, literally purchase with money forgiveness for yourself or for a loved one to reduce the amount of time you had to spend in purgatory. In the 32nd thesis, Martin said, "Those who believe that they can be certain of their salvation because they have indulgence letters will be eternally damned together with their teachers." He had really struggled with the Scriptures during his time as a monk. He really dealt with his own sin. He was known to sleep on the floor with no blanket, no pillow. He would punish himself because he thought he was so unworthy of the calling that he had. But in his study of the Scriptures, he would discover the truth of justification by faith alone, and that would really drive his objections to the teaching of the church. He would later condemn the whole idea of purgatory altogether. And this event on the 31st of 1517 would really spark the beginning of the end of what were known as the spiritual dark ages. The Reformation would usher in a period of spiritual enlightenment. Over many, many years, the motto of the Reformation would become the Latin expression post tenebris lux. If you speak Latin, I'm sorry that I'm saying it that way. I've been told I have an accent. I don't hear it, so I'm just saying it. If you don't speak Latin, don't worry, there's not a spelling test. The motto simply means after darkness, light, or after darkness, there will be light. And it may seem strange that these ideas were so popular, but remember, this was only about 60 years after the invention of the printing press by Johannes Gutenberg. And 15 years after that, he would print the Gutenberg Bible, but it would still not be prevalent. There was not access to the Scriptures by most of the common people. And so these ideas gained traction, and God would use Luther's objections to really spur on a better understanding of Scripture. So that's our introduction. I'm going to set a timer on my watch that is no indicator of when we're going to be done today. We'll see how it goes. So out of the Reformation, the Reformers would develop a system of theology to help better understand why they had certain objections with the teaching of the Catholic Church. Over time, they would summarize what they believed to be the essentials of Christian faith in what we know today as the five solas of the Reformation. Each of those solas is a statement of belief. We're going to review those this morning really quickly and go through the first four. Had to leave a lot on the cutting room floor, so if you want to talk about it later, we can go to lunch. Our review of these will not be exhaustive. We could spend a long time talking about each of them. What we're going to do is go through the first four, and then we're going to land on Soli Deo Gloria, which is for the glory of God alone. That's the fifth sola. That's where we're going to spend the bulk of our time this morning. Obviously, we're going to go through a lot of Scripture today. I'm going to give you a lot of references, and we're going to read some, but I'm also going to reference a few resources. And in my study, I would recommend these to you. A couple of them are God's Glory Alone, The Majestic Heart of Christian Faith and Life. That's David Van Drunen. It's part of a series called The Five Solas. Each author writes a different sola. and really delves into to how they were developed and what they mean for us. And then secondly, why we're Protestant, an introduction to the five solas of the Reformation by Nate Pickowitz. Recommend that one as well. And then as we go through and summarize some of the first four, I'm going to reference a lot, a book by James Montgomery Boyce, Whatever Happened to the Gospel of Grace. So if you want more resources, that's a good place to start. And then we're going to turn a lot of pages in Scripture today. I've got to make room for that. So real quickly, the five solas are this: sola scriptura, sola gratia, sola fide, solus Christus, and soli Deo Gloria. That's where we're going to spend our time, as I mentioned, but we're going to walk through the first four. In English, that means this: on the authority of Scripture alone, we believe that man is reconciled to God by grace alone, through faith alone, in the person and work of Christ alone, for the glory of God alone. So the first one that we're going to talk through this morning is sola scriptura. I'm going to try to go through to these quickly. As I said, no promises on time today. Sola scriptura means that we believe in the authority of Scripture alone. You're familiar with 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17. All Scripture is breathed out by God and is profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. You can see, based on the objections that Luther listed to the teachings of the church, that this one would be pretty essential. In fact, it is essential for us today that we recognize that Scripture alone is our ultimate authority. It is the foundation for any objection to false teaching and doctrine. I mentioned James Montgomery Boyce. He says this: the Bible alone is our ultimate authority, not the Pope, not the church, not the traditions of the church or church councils, still less personal intimations or subjective feelings, but Scripture only. Therefore, if any of these other authorities depart from Bible teaching, they are to be judged by the Bible and rejected. Small rabbit trail. There are lots of authorities that we have in our lives, and they are instituted by God, and they serve a purpose within the confines that God has given them in which to operate. We have families, we have parents, we have heads of household. God's instituted fathers to lead their homes. He's instituted civil authorities, that includes law enforcement, government, all those things, and all of them have a God-ordained sphere in which they operate. And when they are outside of the authority of Scripture, we must rest on Scripture alone, not on the authorities that have been established by man. If we are not willing to submit ourselves to Scripture and acknowledge its inerrancy and its sufficiency in all things as God's inspired word to us, then we are easily going to be led astray. We're subject to every blowing wind of vain philosophy, as Scripture says. We'll be taken captive by eloquent speech if we don't understand what Scripture says. There are a lot of weird, false ideologies that are in the church today that you don't have to go far to look for them. There are churches that are teaching anything but the truth. We don't have to name them. They're all over. You see it in the headlines, and you see it, unfortunately, even in supposed Christian teaching. But I'm going to say this. The greatest threat to the church today is not any of those ideologies or any particular false teaching, but a biblical illiteracy that would allow any or all of them to flourish. I love being outside. It is beautiful out here today. I'm going to say that one more time. The greatest threat to the church is a generator that's revving up.
And just shut up. All right, you guys might just have to get closer. As we check on the generator. Who can still hear me? All right, keep going. The greatest threat to the church is not any particular false teaching, but a biblical illiteracy that would allow any or all of them to flourish. Our foundation is the Scripture and the Word of God. We're not standing on this, and we're not standing on anything that is worth anything. The Reformers knew that, and that's why they proclaimed the doctrine of sola scriptura, Scripture alone. The second sola was sola gratia. You guys know Ephesians 2, 8, and 9. By grace we're saved through faith. It is a gift of God. It's not your own doing. not the result of works, so that no one can boast. We see the same in Titus chapter 2, verses 11 through 14. Salvation is by grace alone. We understand grace to be unmerited favor. It's distinct from mercy. God's mercy removes from us the debt that we couldn't pay, but he doesn't just take us back to a zero balance and say, all right, get out of here, you don't owe me anything. He fills our account based on the merits of Jesus Christ, and he shows us grace by bringing us into his kingdom. He welcomes us based on the righteousness of his own Son. Grace alone can bring salvation to dead men. That's the way that we're described in the scriptures. We're described as spiritually dead without hope, and God makes us alive together with him in Christ. We see that in 2 Corinthians chapter 2. We see it in Titus 3 verses 4 through 7, that God regenerates our hearts by the Spirit. We have to understand our own inability to save ourselves. We're totally dependent on grace. We talked about this in our men's Bible study yesterday, that if you're dead, none of us have ever seen a corpse open his eyes, sit up and raise his hand and say, I need help. You can't do it. We're spiritually dead. We're unable. The work of the Spirit is to redeem us, and it's grace alone that allows God to do that. It is only his gracious loving kindness that brings redemption. Is this working again?
Yeah, it's working now. I don't need to recap that, right? You guys hear it? Montgomery Boyce again, he summarizes sola gratia, grace alone, that God owes us nothing except just punishment for our many and very willful sins. Therefore, if he does save sinners, which he does in the case of some but not all, it is only because it pleases him to do it. It is grace alone expressed through the supernatural work of the Holy Spirit that brings us to Christ, releasing us from our bondage to sin and raising us from death to spiritual life. Sola gratia, grace alone. Sola fide, it is through faith alone that this is accomplished. Romans chapter 3, verses 27 and 28. Galatians chapter 2, 15 and 16. Galatians 3, 1 through 3. Faith alone in the finished work of Christ can justify us before God. That's the revelation that Luther had as he studied the scriptures. He realized that he could not justify himself before God. It was only faith in Christ. We can't add to the work of Christ by completing a checklist of good works, but rather works, as we see in James, are the outflow, the byproduct of a true regenerative faith. They're not co-contributors to our justification, but they are the result of our justification by faith. It's a legal term. Boyce says justification is a declaration of God based on the work of Christ. It flows from God's grace, and it comes to the individual not by anything he or she might do, but by faith alone, sola fide. Solus Christus, it happens as our faith must be in the person and work of Christ alone. John 14, 6, Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through me. Romans chapter 3, verses 22 through 26. No one could accomplish the vicarious atonement that was required for the remission of our sins except Christ. 1 Peter 2, verse 24. Acts 4, 11 and 12 says there's no other name under heaven whereby we must be saved. The work of Christ alone cancels our cosmic sin debt. We see that in Colossians chapter 2, verses 11 through 15. Again, Boyce in summary says this doctrine affirmed that our salvation has been accomplished once for all by the mediatorial work of the historical Jesus Christ alone. His sinless life and substitutionary atonement alone are sufficient for our justification, and any gospel that fails to acknowledge that or denies it is a false gospel that will save no one. And then lastly, we arrive at Soli Deo Gloria. That's where we're going to spend the rest of our time this morning. Thank you guys for getting that back on. I would have had to yell for a long time. My kids would tell you I can do that, but I don't like to. Soli Deo Gloria gained notoriety in the 18th century thanks to Johann Sebastian Bach. If you saw the Facebook advertisement yesterday for this morning, what you saw was his inscription at the end of one of his compositions. It said Soli Deo Gloria, or sometimes he would simply put SDG at the end of his compositions. It was to indicate that the work he had done was to make God look glorious, not himself. It speaks to the ultimate purpose of all that God does from creation to redemption. It is for his glory. This is where we're going to camp out this morning, and it's why we started in Isaiah chapter 43. As we dig into that this morning, I'm going to give you a preview of where we're headed. We're going to answer two questions, and then in good puritanical fashion, we're going to arrive at three alliterative points of application, and then we're going to conclude as we transition into receiving the elements of communion this morning. Isaiah 43 again said, "Fear not, for I am with you. I will bring your offspring from the east. From the west I will gather you. I will say to the north, give up, and to the south, do not withhold. Bring my sons from afar and my daughters from the end of the earth. Everyone who is called by my name, whom I created for my glory, whom I formed and made." God has claim on our lives, and he's jealous for his glory because he created us. He is our source. Let's answer a couple of key questions and define some terms so that we understand what we're talking about. What is the glory of God, and what do we mean when we say the glory of God? We're going to look at a couple of quick explanations. We're going to get some help from Dr. John Piper and from Nate Pickowitz, who wrote the book that I mentioned earlier. This one's a little lengthy, so hang in there. It says, "The reason it is so important is because in the Bible, I don't know of any truth that is more fundamentally pervasive than God's zeal to be glorified, which means his zeal for us to think, so to feel, and so to act, as to make him look as glorious as he is. We don't add to his glory." He says, "I believe the glory of God is the going public of his infinite worth. I define the holiness of God as the infinite value of God, the infinite intrinsic worth of God. And when that goes public in creation, the heavens are telling the glory of God, and human beings are manifesting his glory because we're created in his image and we're trusting in his promises so that we make him look gloriously trustworthy. The public display of the infinite beauty and worth of God is what I mean by glory." He says, "I base that partly on Isaiah 6, where the seraphim say, 'Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory.'" So God's glory is the radiance of his holiness, the radiance of his manifold, infinitely worthy and valuable perfections. Pickowitz is much more succinct. He says, "The glory of God is the manifestation of his person and presence." It's more than this just kind of out there concept in the ether. It is the sum of everything that God is. We closed our singing this morning with "Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus." Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of the earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Sometimes, at least in my mind, I've relegated this to a metaphorical meaning, right? Saying, well, the things of the world lose their luster when we realize how glorious God is. But the hymn writer didn't say, "in light of his glory and grace." He said, "in the light of his glory and grace." So glory is not just the sum of his attributes, it's a actual radiance of light that makes everything else look dim by comparison. We see that in creation order. Genesis chapter 1, verse 3, God said, "Let there be light." Does anybody know when he made the sun and the moon? 13 verses later, there was light. God made light. Because God is light. He was glorious. His glory produces radiance. We see that in Exodus chapter 16, when his glory cloud led the Israelites through the wilderness, he guided them with his glory that was veiled in the cloud. In Exodus 33, Moses makes the bold claim, "Show me your glory." And God says, "You can't behold my glory and live." We know what happened in the story. He says, "I'll hide you in the cleft of the rock and I'll pass by. And as I pass by, you can see me just a glimpse from behind. That's all you can handle." But it was more than just physical light. Bringing it back to it's the sum of who God is. Pickowitz makes a comment about this. He says, "There's a second component to Moses' encounter with God. As he passes by him, the Lord proclaims his own name and declares his attributes. He emphasizes the Lord God, his proper name, Yahweh, Yahweh. And then he begins to list various aspects of his character and nature. Specifically, he makes note of his compassion, graciousness, forbearance, loving kindness, truthfulness, forgiveness, and justice. More than simply showing Moses a visible display brighter than 10,000 suns, he offers him a summary of all that he is, the sum of his divine attributes. In Exodus 34, later in that chapter, Moses speaks with the Lord. And remember, as he would commune with the Lord, he would have to wear a veil because the glory of the Lord would shine brightly on his face just from the reflection of the time that he had spent with them. And the other Israelites in the camp couldn't look at him, so he'd have to cover his face with a veil. So we see that God's glory is there is a physical radiance element to it that is bright, too bright for us to behold, but it results from the sum of all his attributes and character. Is his glory is his nature. So if that's what it means to see God's glory, or that's what God's glory is, then what does it mean for us to glorify God? How can we do things to the glory of God alone? The very first question in the Westminster Catechism is, what is the chief end of man? And the answer is, man's chief end is to glorify God and to enjoy him forever. In a study guide for this catechism, G.I. Williamson writes, to glorify God does not mean to make God glorious. God is already glorious. He has been glorious from all eternity, and nothing created by God can ever make him more glorious than he already is. To glorify God must therefore be understood this way. It means to reflect God's glory. We see this in Psalm 19:1. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the sky above proclaims his handiwork. The chief end of the heavens and the earth, then, is to declare or show forth the glory of God. Think about this morning, brothers and sisters. God is never more glorious. He never has been and never will be more glorious than he is at this very moment. He's always the same. He is always as glorious as he ever has been. Pickowitz comments, however, the sense is not that we give glory to God or that we give to God what he already possesses. Rather, we recognize and acknowledge his glory. God is jealous for his glory, and rightfully so. He proclaims, I will not give my glory to another. Isaiah chapter 42. R.C. Sproul writes this, God's glory is not the highest good, or is the highest good, and therefore is the purpose for which we were created. We were made to glorify him, to reflect his glory, and to proclaim it in all creation. Salvation must be sola fide, sola gratia, and solus Christus, through faith alone, by grace alone, and on account of Christ alone, because to attribute redemption to our efforts in any way is to rob God of his full glory. So then to summarize these two questions, if we understand that God's glory is the completeness of his attributes and character, they radiate in blinding light, and that we glorify him by portraying him to the world in the clearest way that we can so that his glory is made manifest. We glorify God by saying, look at God, isn't he glorious? We're going to spend the rest of our time looking at three points of application this morning. I do want to mention, though, as the wind blows and it's a little chilly, I know on good authority there's coffee back there in the back, and you can do jumping jacks and stand up and get around. I am really hard to offend, so just make yourself comfortable. We're going to look at three points of application of what it means if we live Soli Deo Gloria. We understand a little bit now of what God's glory is and how we glorify him. So if we live for the glory of God alone, what does that do? I want to tell you this morning that it empowers us to do three things. We'll look at each of them. It empowers us to speak fervently, suffer fearlessly, and serve faithfully. Let's look at each one of those this morning, what Scripture says. Living for God's glory alone empowers us to speak fervently. To speak of God's glory is a doxology. We're going to sing that in just a little bit. Paul gives a doxology in almost all of his letters. You guys know the ology part, right? That comes from the Greek word logos. It means word about. We use it to use study of. We have biology, study of life, anthropology, the study of man, theology, the study of God, and a whole bunch of ologies under that. And it literally means a word about those things. So doxology then is a word about doxa, which is glory. To give God praise is literally saying, let me share a word about God's glory. So we praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. I heard that, Rod. we're commanded to, and we have the privilege of joining in the chorus of creation. We get to join in the chorus of this creation this morning. The psalmist declares that in Psalm 19, 1 and 2. We just read one of those, Psalm 104, 31 and Psalm 148. The psalmist also repeatedly implores us to praise God with our words, specifically with our speech. Psalm 106, 1, 113, 1, 117, 1, 135, 3, specifically in song, and 147, 1, just to name a few. There are many more. Psalm 102 says specifically to record the deeds of the Lord for the expressed purpose of future generations praising Him. Hebrews 13:15 says, through Him, speaking of Jesus, then let us continually offer up a sacrifice of praise to God, that is, the fruit of lips that acknowledge His name. Speaking praise with our lips is our sacrifice of worship. I mentioned that Paul includes a doxology in nearly all of his letters. Romans 11 is a wonderful example. Beginning in verse 33, he says, oh, the depth of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God, how unsearchable are His judgments and how inscrutable His ways. For who has known the mind of the Lord, and who has been His counselor? Or who has given to Him a gift that He might be repaid? For from Him and through Him and to Him are all things. To Him be glory forever. Amen. So when we live Soli Deo Gloria, for the glory of God alone, it enables us, it empowers us to speak up and to speak fervently about who He is. Sometimes we're a little flippant with praise the Lord, right, when something good's happening. How weird would people look at you if you said instead, isn't God glorious? Isn't He good to us? Secondly, living for God's glory alone empowers us to suffer fearlessly. How many of you in your lives have struggled with fear or anxiety or depression as a result of your suffering? You don't have to raise your hand. If you haven't up until this point, the last 2 years, I'm willing to bet you've dealt with a little anxiety. There's a lot of stuff going on in the world, right? I bet most of you have lost a loved one, fought your own health issues. Maybe you faced your own mortality. Maybe your struggles have been financial. I guarantee you, you're worried about your kids and the world that they're going to grow up in. We are guaranteed suffering in our lives, but we do not have to fear. We can endure that without fear. 2 Timothy 1, 6 and 7. For this reason, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For God gave us a spirit not of fear, but of power, love, and self-control. You're like, yeah, I know that verse, Josh, but you don't have any idea what my suffering is. Well, let me give you two reasons why we can suffer fearlessly. The first is because the glorious God that we serve, part of His glory is His sovereignty. He's in control. And He's already told us that everything He does is for His glory, so we can trust Him. We see example after example of that in Scripture, and we can probably point to a few examples in our own life of God's faithfulness to us. But one example comes from Job. In the first 20 verses of the book, we see Job's life get absolutely obliterated. He loses everything he has. He loses his kids, his wealth, his property. And in verse 21, he responds and says, naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked I shall return. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. 1 Peter chapter 5, beginning in verse 6. It says, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time He may exalt you, casting all your cares on Him, because He cares for you. Be sober-minded and be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion seeking someone to devour. Resist him, firm in your faith, knowing that the same kinds of suffering are being experienced by your brotherhood throughout the world. And after you have suffered a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to His eternal glory in Christ, will Himself restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. To Him be the dominion forever and ever. Amen. In his morning-by-morning commentary on the first two verses that we just read, the Prince of Preachers, Charles Spurgeon, writes the following. This one's lengthy, but if you're fighting with suffering right now, I encourage you to listen closely. And I wish I could read it in as powerful a voice as I hear it in my head. But you'll just have to deal with what I can do. He says, it is a happy way of soothing sorrow when we can feel he cares for me. Christian, do not dishonor your religion by always wearing a brow of care. Come cast your burden upon the Lord. You are staggering beneath a weight which your father would not feel. What seems to you a crushing burden would be to him but as small as the small dust of the balance. Nothing is so sweet as to lie passive in God's hands and know no will but his. O child of suffering, be thou patient. God has not passed you over in his providence. He who is the feeder of sparrows will also furnish you with what you need. Sit not down in despair. Hope on. Hope ever. Take up the arms of faith against the sea of trouble, and your opposition shall yet end your distresses. There is one who cares for you. His eye is fixed on you. His heart beats with pity for your woe, and his hand omnipotent shall yet bring you the needed help. The darkest cloud shall scatter itself in showers of mercy. The blackest gloom shall give place to the morning. He, if you are one of his family, will bind up your wounds and heal your broken heart. Doubt not his grace because of your tribulation, but believe that he loves you as much in seasons of trouble as in times of happiness. What a serene and quiet life might you lead if you were to leave providing to the God of providence. With a little oil in the cruse and a handful of meal in the barrel, Elijah outlived the famine, and you will do the same. If God cares for you, why need you care too? Can you trust him for your soul and not for your body? He has never refused to bear your burdens. He has never fainted under their weight. Come then, soul, have done with fretful care, and leave all your concerns in the hand of a gracious God. If you belong to the Lord this morning, he has demonstrated his faithfulness to you. And so I'll just repeat the words of Spurgeon and say, hope on, hope ever. He's faithful. But he's given us more than that, because when we live for the glory of God alone, not only can we rest in his sovereignty and his faithfulness to us, but we know that we have something greater ahead of us, because the glory of God itself is our inheritance, and it awaits us in eternity. Romans chapter 8, 18 says, for I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing to the glory that is to be revealed to us. They don't fall into the same category. They don't show up on the same chart. We all know Romans 8, 28. We know that those who love God, for those who love God, all things work together for good for those who are called into his, according to his purpose. But keep reading the next two verses. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. The tense of that is important. Paul is communicating that this is complete. It's done. It is sure. 2 Corinthians 3:18 and 2 Corinthians 4, verses 13 through 17 say much the same. The final two verses of that passage say, we do not lose heart, though our outer self is wasting away. Our inner self is being renewed day by day. For this light, momentary affliction is preparing us for an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison. David Van Drennen, I mentioned earlier, he comments on the idea of glorification, noting it's a little perplexing. He says, the glorification of believers in Christ is the glorification of God. To confess Soli Deo Gloria is to proclaim in part that he alone has worked such a great salvation by grace through faith in Christ. Christians will not share Christ's glory in the sense that anyone will ever bow down and worship them, but in the supreme glorification of Christ, believers are swept up into abiding communion with their Lord. Their holiness, their righteousness, and even their bodies will reflect the glory of their King. The glorification of his people redounds to the glory of God. Friends, when you're going through suffering, remember that our inheritance is that we will spend eternity basking in God's glow of infinite worth. We won't remember the light and momentary afflictions that may currently besiege us. Psalm 73:25-26, whom have I in heaven but you, and on earth there is nothing I desire besides you. My flesh and my heart may fail, but the Lord is, God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. Portion there is most frequently translated portion, but it's also translated inheritance, reward, or share. God himself is our reward. Living for God's glory alone allows us to suffer fearlessly. Lastly, living for God's glory allows us to serve faithfully. Speaking about the first four solas, Pickowitz says, "But this God-centered view of salvation is not meant to produce lazy Christians who sit around and merely bask in the notion that they've been justified by faith apart from any works. It is not meant to produce a dead faith which lacks obedience. Rather, all of the Christian life exists for the expressed purpose of bringing glory to God. Yes, all things are to be done for the glory of God alone." Soli Deo Gloria. You probably know 1 Corinthians 10:31. "So whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God." Paul's addressing the Corinthians here about things that are matters of Christian liberty, because they're matters of conscience. He had just talked to them about meat sacrificed to idols, and he's saying you can eat or not eat. It's a matter of conscience, and you shouldn't violate your conscience, and you shouldn't violate the conscience of another. So we can apply this same concept to any matter of conscience we're dealing with today. It's frequently used in reference to, are you going to drink alcohol? You're not going to drink alcohol. What about, are you going to get a shot or are you not going to get a shot? Are you going to wear a mask or not wear a mask? Those are matters of conscience. God doesn't address those in scriptures, and so we do what the Spirit leads us to do. And what Paul would say is, whatever you do, do it in a way that makes God look glorious. If you can't, then you have your answer. All things that we do are for the purpose of God's glory, even things that are matters of conscience. We read Ephesians 2:8-9, but look at verse 10. He says, "We are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them." It is God's will that in his redemption for us, that we then walk in good works in obedience to him. And he tells us the purpose beautifully in the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5:16. Jesus says this, "In the same way, let your light shine before others." And he gives us the purpose of that, "so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven." The purpose of our works is so that others will see how glorious God is, and they too will give him glory. Owen Strahan is a professor at Grace Baptist Theological Seminary in Arkansas. He has a podcast called The Antithesis. He delivered a message a few weeks or months ago by the same title, Soli Deo Gloria. And in it, he says that the God-glorifying life is the life that begins in the goodness of the gospel. And everything comes from that. He makes the point in his message that everything matters, even the small things. He quotes C.S. Lewis, who says, "Most men must glorify God by doing something which is not per se an act of glorifying, but it becomes so by being offered." Again, Paul would go back and say, whether you eat or drink, he might add, whether you work on cars or build houses, take care of sick people, whatever you do, do it in a way that makes God look glorious. When we live for God's glory alone and we don't seek our own, it enables us to serve faithfully because he is our prize. We're fulfilling the purpose for which he made us. "Fear not, for I am with you. I will bring your offspring from the east and from the west. I will gather you. I will say to the north, give up, and to the south, do not withhold. Bring my sons from afar and my daughters from the end of the earth. Everyone who has been called by my name, whom I created for my glory, who I formed and made." As we wrap up this morning, David Van Drunen writes, "But the truly striking thing about Christ's ministry and its cause of offense to many in Israel was his embrace of humility. He took on human flesh and blood. He was born in a stall. He had no beauty or majesty that we should desire him, and he became obedient to death, even death on a cross." He goes on, "None of this appeared very glorious, but Scripture teaches that God was glorified even in Christ's humiliation. It magnified the grace and mercy of God towards his people. For Christ's humiliation accomplished precisely what the Old Testament showed that his people needed: the forgiveness of their sins and reconciliation with a holy God. And this is why the doctrine that all glory belongs to God does not make us irrelevant or worthless. For God wills to glorify himself in part through the salvation of his people. He not only raised his Son from the dead by the power of the Spirit, but in Christ he also pours his Spirit upon poor sinners now and will raise us one day from the dead to behold the glory of Christ in the new creation. God glorifies himself through our glorification. As we get ready to receive communion this morning, if you don't have the elements of communion, just raise your hand and somebody will bring those to you. I want us to bring this together with Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 through 4. Long ago, at many times and in many ways, God spoke to our fathers by the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed the heir of all things, through whom also he created the world. He is the radiance of the glory of God and the exact imprint of his nature. He upholds the universe by the word of his power. After making purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. See, God, for his glory, chose to redeem us by making purification through his glory in human form. It says that Jesus is the radiance of the glory of God, the exact imprint of his nature. And yet we know in Philippians he humbled himself, taking the form of a man to come and live a perfect life. And as verse 4 says, make purification for our sins so that God would be glorified. As he prepared to head to the cross where he would provide that purification, the Apostle Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 11 that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it. He said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Take and drink. I want to ask our prayer team to come up to the stage now as we close, as we get ready to sing a song of doxology. I want to ask you a couple of questions. Have you been living for your glory, attempting to rob God of what is rightfully his? He won't let you have it. Scripture says he's jealous for it. It's his and you don't have any claim over it. And you'll find great freedom in living for his glory alone. So come this morning and just offer a prayer of repentance. Many of us may need to do that. Are you one of those folks that's enduring suffering right now, and you've been enduring it with fear and anxiety and depression? Come and unburden yourself of that this morning. Cast your cares on the King of Kings. He won't feel the weight of it. Come and pray with one of these fellow saints. They'd love to lift you up to the Lord this morning. Or perhaps, you don't have to fit one of these categories, but perhaps you just want to give God a doxology this morning and praise him for how faithful he's been to you. Then encourage one of these members of the prayer team by coming up and offering that prayer with him and just praise God for who he is. I'm going to say a quick prayer for us, and then you guys come as you want to pray. You can pray by yourself. You can pray with one of these folks as we sing together this morning to close out. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for loving us. Lord, that our prize is to see you in the radiance of your glory. God, you're preparing us for that. You've promised us that you will glorify us. It's as good as done. Father, we'll get to spend eternity in the radiance of your glory, where we won't need a sun or a moon because the light is brighter than 10,000 suns. God, praise you for letting us join in the chorus of creation and fulfill our highest purpose to live for your glory alone. Help us to do that, Father. Help us to lean into you, to trust you, and to remember your faithfulness. We love you, Father. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Stand together.
Dying breath has brought me life, and I know I
this I know. But this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom. Oh, his wounds have paid my ransom. Hallelujah. Let's pray one more time. Father in heaven, you are glorious. We stand in awe of your majesty this morning. As we leave this place, Father, let everything we say and do bring honor and glory to the name of Jesus alone. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
He's a faker too.
He is, he really is.